Okay. Now listen to that. 40% of all the cows in Canada have Jones disease. And the health officials know everything about it.
Mm-hmm.
We had a session with a veterinarian researcher from the University of Guelph at a farmer conference. They're not talking about how to eradicate yonis. What they're talking about, how you as a farmer tell the public there's no problem with yonis. The head veterinarian of Canada said, if I would pull the trigger on that whole yonis disease, I would destroy the entire dairy industry in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So they can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, what is the danger with yonis? The danger is that you might get infected and you get Crohn's disease. Yonis, the occurrence of yonis in cows and the occurrence of Crohn's disease goes totally parallel, okay? It's a scary scenario. Now the interesting thing beyond that is that the yonis bacteria is going through the pasteurization process,
mm-hmm.
Yeah? So they have these flash pasteurizations. The yonis have a very thick membrane, and it goes through the pasteurization, and the yonis are still active when you actually drink pasteurized milk. Okay, so it's not only a question the safety of raw milk; it is also a question: are you sure that that pasteurized milk is actually safe to drink? And I would say it's even worse than anything else. Okay, so requirements should be that you test your cows against yonis. That the cows are yonis free, that the cows are tuberculosis free, that the cows are brucellosis free, and the other thing is that, you know, like Gary was talking about, once you strengthen a cow through the management, through the fertility management, the soil management, you actually eliminate a lot of these problems you would normally have when you put a cow under stress. Imagine that our cows give 3,500 liters per year. Okay. Can somebody tell me what the average production nowadays is from cows in Canada?
10,000 in a whole 1,500.
10,000. However.
You said a number of years ago 17,000.
Okay. By now we have cows which give 30,000 liters, 10 times the amount.
Oh my God. Effluent.
Yeah.
No.
30,000 liters of milk. Yeah.
Ten times.
Per cow.
Wow.
Ten
that's
times.
Per lactation?
Per lactation. Per
you
year.
Know what lactation is? What your guy?
9 months. You know, 9 months of production.
Okay.
30,000 liters. 20
wow.
to 30,000 liters of milk. So, quality of milk, nutrient of milk. You cannot, if I would ask you, besides the point that we don't have 36 hours a day, but if I would ask you to work for 24 hours a day, yeah, what would happen with you? You would last, I don't know how long you would last. Yeah, your attention goes down, your quality of work goes down, and then you collapse. Now, the cows in North America and in Canada have only a production of maximum 2 years, and then they're out, they're gone. That's the average production life of a cow. Yeah, you come to our farm, our cows are 10, 12, 15 years old, yeah, which is so much more longer than what the average cow nowadays in North America can live. So you have all these factors. You're not breeding longevity with the cow anymore. You're breeding basically a fast
turnover.
Fast turnover in your herd, because they wouldn't last longer, the feed wouldn't last, you know, their hooves wouldn't last, all these things, because they're not going out on pasture. So, breed. If you're part of a cow share, if you're looking for a cow share operation, important is to ask what kind of breeds you have. And the worst breed you can have for a cow share operation, unfortunately, is, and some people might not like that when I say that, is the Holstein cow.
Right.
The Holstein cow is the worst animal, the most destructive and destroyed animal in regards to breeding, because of what the intentions were. We wanted to have cows who get 20,000 liters of milk. We went through that exercise that we took actually Holstein cow in the herd, for an experiment, and it took about 3 months, and then they were ready to go to butcher before they died. Okay? Because they actually cannot live without grain. Yeah? These cows cannot live anymore on based on pasture and hay in the winter. It's impossible. Yeah? So, when you want milk and your cows are Holstein cows, then I can already tell you, you need to work on your farmer to slowly move over these Holstein cows into heritage breeds. What are heritage breeds? For example,
breed is designed to have more than one purpose and adapt.
That's a multi-purpose breed, but you're looking, for example, Jerseys are not as bad. They're almost as bad, but they're not as bad as Holsteins. Okay, but they're also pushed quite a bit. There's the Guernsey cow. There's the Shorthorn cow. There's the Canadian cow. Pardon?
Brown Swiss.
Brown Swiss is also pretty well destroyed,
it's
Joseph.
Kerry.
Pardon?
Kerry,
just a perfect cattle.
Very rare, though.
Yeah, very rare. And what is the part of this whole? What unites all these cattle?
Grass, fast, pasturing, and like Gary said.
Yeah.
Originally, in times gone by, people probably were doing it based on nutrition, not quantity.
Yeah.
How did they do that? They watch the cows where they graze. They put them there to graze.
Yes. And what you find with these breeds also, they're not elephants.
No.
Holsteins are elephants nowadays. They're very tall, very big. You need, it's just like when you drive a big car, needs a lot of fuel. Yeah.
Are you looking for the farmer to change to a new breed? Is it okay if the farmer keeps the Holsteins and crosses them with
Can I step in?
Which one of those two?
When I talk to farmers that maybe want to do what Michael's doing and they have one of the other breeds, I say without just slaughtering your whole herd and getting the animals you can't get, I would recommend, Michael maybe doesn't have females to sell, but bulls don't have much priority in a cow herd.
Right.
Other than one special bull,
yeah.
Who's smiling. But so I would always recommend to a farmer, the quickest way to transition is to get a bull calf from Michael and then use that. Don't use artificial insemination. Go back to the proper way.
Okay.
And then now you've just got rid of 50% of your genetics
from
the bad genetics, and you put in 50% good genetics, and by doing the right soil fertility and feeding program, you're going to go through what Michael did over many years. Excuse me, sir. What were the when you bought the farm? What was the breed of animals on the farm?
Holstein.
Oh,
pure Holstein.
So he did it, and you can, and anybody else can do it quicker,
yeah,
by taking advantage of what he's done by incorporating the genetics from his herd into their own herd, and that will be a step in the right direction. And of course, it takes time for those animals to get in production. But each time, if you can maintain the bull as always from his herd pure, then every time you go, you're losing 50% of those genetics. It doesn't take too many generations. So, and one thing I want to point out, that when a farmer has the wrong type of cow and the wrong feed program, but he wants to do what Michael's doing, as Michael says, you just can't transition like that. So if you don't have somebody in your area that's going to produce raw milk, but a farmer who's doing it the wrong way says, I'm going to transition, then if you don't support him by buying the product, he never gets there, and all you can be assured of, as he transitions, the product that you're getting will get better and better, because nutrition is not a light switch, it's like a light switch that slides.
Mm-hmm.
So gradually that nutrition will improve, and it will be evidenced, as with Michael's herd and the transition he went through from Holsteins to what he has now through Carentaise, it's evidenced by the health of the herd.
Mm-hmm.
And what diseases does your herd have? What are the common diseases in your herd?
Free.
Yeah. They don't get sick.
Yeah.
So he doesn't need a veterinarian.
Yeah.
So the only problem with this is going to put a lot of veterinarians out of business.
Okay. Pat, very clear. I think it is important not to kind of scare the farmer away or say, well, you can't do it like that. That is not the intention. It is get him on the program. That's really important to say, well, you cannot keep going with the Holsteins. You need to move into the next level. And that means a slow transition into crossbreeding, and crossbreeding is totally fine. You get incredible results. It's the worst thing to tell a farmer, get rid of your cows. And that's why I never do that. Yeah. but transition your cows into the position so that you have the chances of good
luck. Something that fits us about what Gary's saying too. Soil fertility is number one. The next thing he's mentioning about you're taking a bull from your herd, which is a closed herd since 1988, and you're bringing this into a herd of, say, I don't know, Jerseys or Guernseys, right?
Yeah.
Which would be better than Holsteins. Okay, you have that 50% now. We know the 50% is great, coming from the bull. We've got a 50% unknown. In line with what Gary's saying, I'd rather have that 50% I know about than 100% I don't know about.
Yeah.
And to one thing you said about the Holsteins, you had a Holstein, I think it went to 16 years of age, if I'm not mistaken, and never had problems. And the other thing was, you told me when you were in Germany, the farmers in Germany who had Holsteins in the mountains, it was a disaster. They tore up the fields, they caused avalanches, they caused landslides, it was a mess.
And that has to do, that the relation between, there's an old saying, whatever is on top has to equal what is in the bottom. That means the soil life in the bottom should equal the weight of what is on top.
Yeah.
Now what changed is that the cows got heavier and the soil life got less and less in your soil. And depleted. And then when they sent these Holstein cows up the Alps, the pastures literally collapsed because there was no soil structure. And then the hooves were too heavy and they trampled it and it literally started destroying, and then all erosion and stuff like that in. So, good. Next thing. So we talked about the breed. Inform yourself. And I'm not saying don't trust your farmer, but in order to become a co-producer, you need to understand also what the farmer has to go through. You need to educate yourself. You need to get away from being a sitting consumer and that everything gets fed to you, you know, as you want. Times are over. Yeah? Unless you want to go back to your supermarket, go. You can roll in and roll out. Okay? It is at the end, you pay the price for that anyhow. But once you get on that path, and I always say it's the worst thing you can do. When you had a peaceful life before, you know, just go to the supermarket, get your chips and whatever. It was quite a nice life. You didn't have to think much about it. You just go to the doctor, get your pills and so on, and then after 30 years, you're dead. So that was simple. Once you start getting concerned about what you're eating, life becomes complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Because you suddenly start looking at it, is that good for me or is it not good for me? Then you look at the farm, oh my, you know, what? Where do I even go? Where do I even find farmers nowadays? Yeah. Farmers are now a species at risk. Yeah? There is less than 2% of farmers left in Canada, and of these 2%, 70% are over 55.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Where are the young farmers? They're just not, they're not coming anymore. And that is where we really run in this problem. How do we find now, even when we know about these things, how do we find the farmers? And that is where you come in. We need to nourish our farmers along. We need to find a way how we can actually become partners with the farmer to produce the product. Good. We have we talked about the soil, now we talked about the breeds. Okay? It's easy to look up. Internet is there. There's so much on the internet you can actually research in regards to that. So I can encourage you, if you're interested, and you should be interested, go on the internet and look at that.
Was it in German, though?
It was in German, yeah.
It's probably
in
translated English.
Yeah. So, next thing. Feeding. You eat what... No, you are what you eat. So, same thing with the cows, okay?
So
with
the cows.
If you feed them pig slop, which is mostly grain and stuff like that, you get pig slop out of the back end of the cow, okay? So, one example, I have a lot of universities coming to the farm, very regular, they're coming to the farm. Students, science students, animal science students. So what we're doing is, I go with them through the barns. And then I tell them, if you want to know what quality is, I'll show you that right here, and for sure